to invite me to this very interesting conference, and I enjoyed it very much. And I moved to Europe for almost a year and a half, and I started my new group for devices of complex materials in Zen Institute for Advanced Materials in University of Columbia. So I'm going to talk about today quantum phase control on ion gate interface. So what I'm going to do, I will do some background of a field effect analyzer, which is the core idea in this talk, and some field effect control of quantum phases, and this early, about some early days attempts. And then I will introduce you an ion gate transistor, which is a key device technology now we are using for assessing quantum phases. And I will introduce the basic concept and give an idea of how to make the variations to enrich the capability. And then, actually, I will do I'll give you an overview of a very recent success in the group. Actually, all these work was done after my movement to Netherlands, and they are quite fresh, I think, because this is not the old technique, so we need a new thing. So the thing we will talk about is a Zeeman-protected superconductor, and my collaborator giving it a very nice name, I think superconductivity. And towards a total control of superconductivity, that means we make a very efficient transistor and control the superconductivity with a continuous fashion. And I'll talk about a little bit of new chance when we make a monolith. And then this is a really ongoing asset of the group. So here, I think this is a very simple overview of carrier density control of electron properties. And arguably, carrier density is the real universal control law of the electronic property. And this is really in a very wide range of carrier density, with rich properties in different material systems. So traditionally, and nowadays still very successful, is using the way of chemical doping or chemical module, in a way of using chemistry to make a different type of materials and dope them. And basically we do something like this, we grind, we mix it. You can mix it with a very modern fashion in the factory with a very nice precise control. But this is basically the way that we make the material using chemical way. On the other hand, we have this field effect doping, which is based on the idea of a field effect transistor. The beauty of this is there is the control knob with a field effect. With applied voltage. So we can prepare status of the of our material using in a continuous fashion without making all the difficulty. But the difficulty is that here the assess the carrier density is relatively narrow. So which is already very good for our own electronics nowadays like this. But for the material property, the capability is not as great as the chemical. So this is all in the invention of these transistors, actually by John Madin. And he's famous not only for transistors, but also for the BCS theory of superconductivity. So naturally, there's already a linkage. And it was a very long time ago since this transistor was invented. and later was very successful nowadays in modern electronics. But naturally, there was already an attempt very early on to use a field effect control to control the DC in superconductor. So this is a case. People studied the metallic thin film, and they did a very interesting measurement to control the DC. Actually, they fixed the temperature and started to sweep on the gate to see whether there was a change of the resistivity. And then they plotted with this slope here, and then they start to analyze the data of shifting of DC. And the point, the amount of shift they are able to achieve is about 10 to the minus 4 Kelvin. So it's really small change. In other words, they get a very good, great job. And this is through a field effect of Mike. And they also did some work on not only indium but also tin. And in that case, change of DC is positive. So very early on, people already did some very interesting job to use field effect to control the transition temperature of superconductor. And the dream of control this superconductivity is in an even bigger dream of control more general the quantum phase that is appeared in a very relatively high direction adjacent to the, for instance, silicon into this semiconductor metal region. So even silicon, if you don't very seriously, you can actually turn it into a superconductor. Then the problem is that whether you are able to do this using only field effect, in other words, whether your transistor is strong enough to access this regime using the field effect or electrostatic wave. That's basically the question, and people keep looking into this for the past half century.
So it's known to be a superconductor, or it's clearly that it's a superconductor?
I cannot hear very clearly. Can you repeat the question?
Yeah, so heavy doping, the silicon is known to be a superconductor in some way, or it's theory that tells you that it will be a superconductor?
Well, it's already a superconductor with doping. Yeah, it's superconducting already. With very dense doping.
So what doping is that?
I think it's boron doping. So there's quite a lot of attempts to access this kind of dream, and one of the organizers in the audience, did very early on some attempt to gain the Schwarzschild tightening, and their first attempt is to deposit the aluminum oxide on a substrate of a strong tire. And it works very nicely as a transistor. But the problem is that they are probably, due to this deposition of oxide, there are some generating of oxygen deficiency, and the mobility is not very good. And later, a new technique of gating was developed using the pyrolyne, which is an organic material, so they prevent this kind of problem. And actually, with a different gate, they can access the metallic regime. And actually, if you gate to a decent amount of carrier density, and when you cool your sample down to very low temperature, and it can show some the superconducting behavior. It was in 2009. The other way of making this kind of attempt is to use another type of gate, which is a ferroelectric gate. But the main player is a lead titanium. And the ferroelectric gate by PDT, mainly in the group of Swisscom in Geneva. Did some very interesting work of switching the superconductivity, and this was done in ultra-thin film of cuprate. And you can see that with the application of gate, these things show insulated behavior, and while the another curve can still, without gating, the other curve shows superconductivity. And by making different thin film, for instance, by making now being both the strength and tightening, they can use the PDT and actually control the TC with different gating and access actually TC through this this dome structure of strength and tightening. And because of this PDT material, actually once you put charge there, it will stay there. And so you can address this kind of, make this kind of address by using a cantilever. And you can have a shift of this TC with a on or off state. So this is a clever way of using a new gate dielectrics. And there are other dielectrics which is called strength and tightening by itself, and working on the interface superconductivity of RLOFT. So by the year 2007, there was a report in Science. These now the very famous interface become superconducting. After year 2004, maybe Bell Lab, where they discover this two-dimensional electron gas. And the substrate itself, SPO, can show a very large dielectric constant when this is device cool down to the low temperature. So if you put a gate at the back, although this substrate is very thick, still you are able to access a very effective gating. So that's what they show here. It's not so clear, and because this is very thick, they can just put voltage there without suffering from breakdown. So the voltage is 300 volt, minus 300 volt, plus 300 volt. So over the range of 600 volt. But they can actually switch very nicely from superconducting phase to the insulating phase. And if you plot this TC as a function of gate voltage, and they can show that with increase of gate voltage is basically proportional to the carrier density. So you can view this. You can view this as a carrier density. So with the increase of carrier density, they can map out this dome kind of superconducting phase. And use this kind of very special dielectric constant. And people can enhance this effect by thinning this down. Actually, they thin this down to about so the whole thickness. Usually, if you buy a substrate, the thickness is 0.5 millimeter, and they can thin this down to a scale of like 10 micron. So that by doing this, the field effect is much more. The effect is much more strong, and then they can affect this kind of macroinsulated transition in metallic thin film of bismuth. And by applying a relatively small gate voltage, about 60 volt, close to 100 volt in this range. And then later, in the group of Professor Yuasa, actually at that time we are still in Sendai, one of the colleagues started the work of using ionic liquid gating. So these are the very early success, and later I did the work of using 2D material and use ionic liquid gating, and then later many other groups are followed. To apply these ideas to high-density cuprate, and then they can switch these, all of us can access superconductivity, And this switch can be nicely made between superconducting phase and insulating phase. And so then, in the follow-up talk, I'm going to talk about the basic ideas of this technique, that is ionic liquid gating, that I introduced in the previous slide. So the basic idea is very simple. It's actually a high school experiment. So basically, that is what we call electrolysis. And we do this experiment in an electrochemical cell with solution with ionic intermediate. And we apply a voltage between these two electrodes that insert into this ionic intermediate. If you apply a gate voltage, there's a building electric field between these two electrodes. And then ions start to move. And if the electric field is not too big, that means ion doesn't react chemically at the surface. And then the configuration will be something like these ions accumulate at the surface of this electrode. And this accumulation swing out the electric field. Then the ion in the ball stop movement. And this kind of configuration is called this kind of configuration gives rise to a very thin capacitor, and this is called Helmholtz electrical double layer, named by this gentleman, and he discovered this 150 years ago. And nowadays, this kind of concept is very widely commercially used. Actually, there are commercial products. This is called charge accumulation device, and mainly used in capacitor. So this is a Japanese company. They use this kind of capacitor bank to store the solar energy, and this is used for this road lamp. So it's a very mature market already. But electronically, this can be transferred into a transistor, actually, using the same idea. The only difference is that we made a source and drain instead of two electrodes, and this counter electrodes previously in the solution, it will act as a gate. So by applying a gate voltage here, the ions start to move, and these ions accumulate on the surface, and which induces the charge into the material. So there's a lot of interesting point here. For instance, this gate, liquid gate, doesn't have to be on top of this material. So it can be in anywhere. If this ionic media connect this channel material and the gate. So we don't have this limitation of blocking our material. So there are quite a lot of possibilities, for instance, for optical characterization, which haven't been done nowadays very extensively. So and there are also quite a lot of variations. For instance, we can have different materials at the gate here, and oxide, normal semiconductor, halogenide, and simple metallic thin film all have been tested using this kind of configuration. And then we can have a big variation with this ionic medium actually by itself. So we can choose inorganic ionic medium, basically it's sodium chloride, which is the first used in gating nanotube by the group of Wong Kim. And then nowadays we extensively use organic gate media, which is a very big family, consists of a lot of members. And I mean, they have different properties, like how low they can go to, how low they can still be gated. And you choose one of them for your purpose.
Sorry, Mr. is very basic here. So there is which Which one is the sample?
Here is the sample. So here is the channel.
That's and this is substrate on which the sample is. The purple thing is the substrate.
So you can, for instance, you can only take a piece of substrate, for instance, sharpen tightening, and just make this kind of probe and define a channel which is contacted with the media. Then the substrate itself can be a sample. Or in this case, I put a piece of a transition metal double channel in here, and this is my sample. Mm-hmm. So basically, or you make a thin film of these metal, and then you define a whole bar structure, then this is a sample. In case all of them are immersed into the liquid.
So the liquid is surrounding the whole
thing? Surrounding the whole thing. And the important thing is that liquid is surrounding the whole thing, and the liquid is connected to this gate electrode. So the ion can be moved.
So, if you go to know the picture, the liquid will be free.
Yeah, yeah. So I'll get to the point. That's it. This is the So then we can use the different organic ion medium. And then we choose a different substrate. Yes, it is actually very important because on top of that, we want to make a backgate, which is also playing an increasing role nowadays to continuously control this quantum phase. And then we want to make a very strong backgate. Silicon dioxide is very good. You can buy this, even buy this wafer. And nowadays we work extensively in hafnium oxide to give him this best control. So, with this kind of configuration, immediately you recognize that the big capability, because we are due to this small separation of a capacitor, we are actually having an order of magnitude capability of accumulating charge. So not only to the limit of a conventional superconductor, we are now to the limit of where the many quantum phase can be accessed. But immediately you recognize something that the surface might play a very important role there. So if we are working with a very flat surface, when carriers are accumulating there, the transport could be very good. But if it is a bad surface, then because these accumulated charge are very close to the surface, you see the roughness immediately. So surface could be an issue here. So that's why the early success on the Shonten tightening was made by my colleague in the year of 2008. And they started this measurement with a very nice common flat surface, which is a very easily accessible in Shonten tightening, because you can just buy this from a company. And once you receive it, more or less, the surface is atomically flat. Or you can request, please give me an atomically flat substrate. So it is very nicely, it's a very nice surface to work with, and they succeeded to access the superconductivity starting from insulating substrate and by basically by gating. But the point here is that the Shonten tightening is the most easy material or most convenient material to work with, because the carrier density required to be superconducting is probably the lowest among all superconductors. And then the second thing is that there's a commercial wafer, and there's a very well-developed technique to make a flat surface. So then this is another very important point that makes this experiment successful. And also this is a quantum parallactic material. And at a low temperature, there's a very huge dynamic constant, and this is the string out of the inverters. So But to the other material, actually, there is still a difficulty. So we have to access a very high, much higher TC. Carrier density is probably 10 or 100 times larger. And atomic flux surface, or good surface quality, is basically not so straightforward. So that's the point that I enter the research, at the moment that I enter the research of using this ion flake. So this is actually, I saw the result the first week I was postdoc in Santa. So after a week I arrived and I see they succeeded. So so afterwards, to push this research forward, we developed some, we started to use a new material for the ionic liquid. The point is that at the time using strontium titanate, my colleague is still using this called some this ionic media called polymer electrolyte. Basically, this is the ion dissolved in a matrix of organic matrix and solvent. So once you make this kind of ionic media, these ions are surrounded by the this ionic by the solvent, and the thickness between them is actually defined by ion size and solvent size. But what, on the other hand, if we use ionic liquid, the material is only the material is basically ionic molecules, and the distance is basically the molecule itself. So we can have a smaller distance between them. And the effectiveness is very big, actually. So that is basically using silicon dioxide gating. And this is polymer electrolyte gating. They're all in the room temperature on the material for the zinc oxide. And this is actually using ionic liquid gating. So we have a big enhancement already here. But the ionic liquid gating can actually perform at low temperature, where the chemical reaction gets suppressed, and there are even more enhancements. But if we just take this kind of carrier density and start to estimate what does it mean by putting this to a material system, so we are talking about carrier density about like 4 to 5, 10 to 14. And if you put this into material system, if you consider a monolayer of fluorine, so if you take the fluorine single crystal and just look down at the surface and count the number of molecules, that is in the number of 10 to 14 molecules per centimeter squared. So that means we have 4 electrons per one fluorine molecule. So 3 electrons per one fluorine molecule is superconducting. And if we put this into a peroxide single crystal, so we look down here, count the number, this is in the order of 10 to 15. That means we have 4.4 electron per one unit cell. So 0.4 electron, that means you have a dope gate, like 0.4. So this is already a very high density dope gate. So in any case, this is a method basically using electrostatic gating to access a regime that is basically accessed previously by the chemistry. So effectiveness of this, I tried very early on material graphene, and we choose a different format of one layer, double layer, triple layer, and we start to gate them, and we see some strange thing here. Basically, one layer we don't see anything. Bilayer we start to see something like this. We start at a flat flattening off and then increase. And triple layer, we also have this kind of feature. And then we compare this with the band structure. So in monolayer, we have a linear band. Bilayer and trilayer, we have this upper band. And these features are actually corresponding to the feature that we, corresponding to the state that we lower or lowering or raising the chemical potential to access the subband. So in this kind of a transistor, carrier opening is so serious, so significant, Fermi levels start to change quite a lot. So we need to consider the shift of the Fermi level when we try to interpret behavior of this transistor. So the typical way of making them is that we use the graphene technique. We use Scotch tape method. We cleave the sample, and this technique is very nice because using a very simple way of optical microscopy, we can check the surface flatness very easily. For instance, if we have such a flake, and then you just change it into a channel of green, so you get rid of this red and blue channel, and then you can easily distinguish there's some contrast difference. And if we compare this with the AFM, and you will see that these contrast difference is actually correspond to a single atomic step. So use this very simple way, you can choose probably the best surface to work with. So people in the graphene community is really thinking about making monolayer. But the beauty of this technique is that not only monolayer, you can choose a very nice surface using a very easy way. So then, for instance, you start with this kind of flake. Then, by careful checking with the contrast in green channel, you can see that there's little contrast over here. So you see that there's a atomic step. And then you just make the channel here. Then you have a very nice surface. So the way of doing, the way of making is no typical than the graphene device. Basically, we cleave and then define the electrodes, and then the last step we make this reservoir. This is the first generation sample, and we make a reservoir and we put the liquid there, and then we made a coil. And this coil we use as the counter electrode, which is for gain. So the coil is somewhere around here. So this is how we started. Actually, I started exactly with this sample, which is called zirconium nitride chloride. Yeah, actually, I'm not finding this intentionally. Basically, the material found me. And the reason is that the group is working on that, so it's very handy that I can just get it from a master student. And the typical feature of this is very similar to graphene. So this is a layered material with a Van't gap. Basically, you can cleave it. And then you use the previous technique to make a divide. Then you start gating. So with increase of gate voltage, the channel connectivity start to increase. And then if we measure the carrier density with Hall effect, the carrier density start to increase with a threshold. And then start to follow a capacitive relationship. And then after a threshold, the channel distance start to, channel mobility start to increase from the bulk mobility to a channel mobility. So we have some kind of threshold here, and it behaves exactly as we expected from a transistor. So back to your question that, of this gate. So what we do is that we fix a carrier density around high temperature, that where these ions are moving. And then we keep this temperature and start to cool this down. And actually, at temperature around slightly below 200 K, these ions are switched out. So ion movement stops. Then at that time, you can even remove this gate voltage, and the system is just a solid state system. So with a different gate, we prepare the system into different doping state, and then we can cool this down to access the state, like taking a snapshot of the state at high temperature. So with the low doping, we are accessing the insulating state. With higher doping, we start to see a metallic phase, and then we see a little bit of superconducting phase. And then with the increase of the gate, we start to have a full superconducting phase.
What is the thickness of the gate?
In this case, it's a really macroscopic.
Thickness of the gate?
So it's a it's immersed into the liquid. It's a bulk liquid. And the thickness of the gate, if you say this electrical double layer, is in the order of 1
How far is the electrode from the you put an electrode, right? The electrical electrode.
So
you apply the voltage.
So that's a macroscopic, right?
Well, what's the distance?
So in here you can make it in millimeters.
The distance from the electrode through the ion liquid, what is that distance?
1 millimeter in this case. You say?
It doesn't matter,
right?
It doesn't
matter.
No, I understand what matters. I just like to ask experimental questions because you guys, you see PowerPoint.
So,
what is the physical distance between the electrode where you apply the voltage and the sample?
So you can use this chip here and gate, for instance, the distance between the bond pad, for instance, this is about 1 millimeter. And then you say this is the distance of bond pad and this is the distance of this coil to the sample, so it's about 1 millimeter. So it's macroscopic. So then we cool this system down. This is actually the first time we see superconductivity, which is out of 0.3K. And the good point of finding this is that now we know that we can actually access high TC, not high TC, but higher TC. And we are accessing a carrier density of a very normal superconductor. And then this combination of using ion liquid and using a nanosheet is important for 2 points. One is important for a flat surface, and this is important for access a very very high carrier density. So immediately we start to work on the second material, which is called monodisulfide. And this is actually a material that is widely used as a lubricant. So it's basically not an electronic material. And we use it, we cleave it, and we make it into a transistor. And the point here is that we now make two gates here. So there's a little gate and there's a high K gate at the bottom. And this high K gate, I will remind you that this is getting more and more important in my research nowadays. So here, the snapshot will be taken at 200K by little gate. And then at low temperature, we are accessing a lower carrier density by changing the voltage through this high K. But this is in a continuous fashion. So we control this property continuously. So this is how it works. So basically by both gates, you can switch the system on. So first of all, you can switch on with an unlimited gate. And you can also switch on with this high K gain. So apparently, even with high K gain, this ion-liquid gating is much more efficient. So it's like 10 times more efficient by a very simple compressor. And this ion-liquid gating can access also the whole current, which is basically shifting the Fermi level to access the valence. So in the output curve of this transistor, we have a electron output, and we also have this hole output. And one thing very important is that in this particular system, I'm very confident this is the electrostatic behavior. Because if you keep gating, at low temperature, ion movement is slow. So we do have a bit of hysteresis. But if you keep moving the ion in one direction, that is, follow the direction of gain, all the curve will follow into one curve. So you can do this up and down many, many times. And this is a signifying that this is a reversible process. And we are really talking about the electrostatic carrier accumulation. So then we cool this system down like what we did before.
If you change the sweeping rate,
these will change, but basically at low temperature, there are always a hysteresis. The width might change a bit, there's always a hysteresis, But if you just follow one direction and forward and backward, they collapse into it.
Thank you, Suresh, all the time you have any capacity, right? When you have too much potential,
eventually,
chemistry would
right, be right, right. So basically you restrict yourself in a region that is these electrostatic doping can occur. Yeah. But eventually, if you just keep pushing, someone must die. So, this is basically we use the same technique by putting the voltage at high temperature and start to cool the system down. So we access the insulating phase, metallic phase with a separation between these two states, and then we start to go to the superconducting phase at high gate voltage. And then we can confirm this is really a superconducting state by applying a magnetic field. And then by measuring a carrier density over around 20K, we can actually map out all the electronic phase. Like here is the superconducting phase, this is metallic phase. So previously we are only talking about the liquid gate. So don't forget we have another gate, which is solid gate at the bottom. And if we fix ourselves at here with the liquid gate, and when we can play with the solid gate with much more precision. So here is we control the carrier density using solid gate to access better mechanism of transition. And then if we proceed with this region with the mechanic phase with a different liquid gate, we can see actually a crossover between localization and weak localization and weak interlocalization, and which is the signature of control the spin orbit interaction with surface. And I will come to that in a minute, which is nowadays getting more and more important. And in the superconducting phase, we fix the superconducting phase with a different liquid gate, and then we start to sweep the solid gate. And at the range here, we can have an increase of DC with different backgate voltage, whereas at the range here, DC gets decreased with the increase of the backgate voltage. So there's a different dependence through this superconducting region. And then we are able to map out all these phase diagrams using a good precision in a continuous fashion in a single sample. And we can compare these electronic phase with the old phase that is accessed by outline of doping, which is in the 70s. And then this is actually working at a very, very different regime. And then one of my colleagues also succeeded in doping potassium tungsten, which is also showing a superconductivity using the field effect. So these two examples are actually telling different stories, because here we are assessing a carrier density, which is relied on low carrier density regime, while here we are assessing a high carrier density regime. So the point here is that we have a layer material. If you want to dope this very uniformly, chemical doping is not a very good idea, especially at low carrier density regime, because the various kinds of effect, staging effect, will occur where the dopant is just not uniform. Here, the material itself is very robust. It's very difficult to insert alien atom inside this substrate. So chemical doping is not very effective. So then you have to go to you have to use a different method to access this high carrier doping regime. So chemistry somehow failed in these two cases in different ways. But then, to be complementary, this field effect doping can affect this region very effectively. So that's the message, that's a good point of using this kind of technique. So then, there's the issue of this dome phase. There's a very famous dome face in Kubrick, and nowadays we have this kind of dome face accessed by field effect in the interface system. And actually, the group of Menard argued that the pseudo gap, something like this Kubrick case in here, although the TC is much lower. And then we have a lot of dome structure nowadays in these simple bands. So this is an interesting observation nowadays, and I think nobody understands the behavior, and I think there's no very clear explanation even in the bulk of the indictment and why this kind of dome phase occurred. And I talked about one material that is MOBI paired with sulfur. But this class of material called a transition metal dichalcogen is actually having MOBI, tungsten, sulfur, selenium, telluride. So it's they have more candidates. And these materials basically forming this one kind of 2H phase semiconducting transition metal dichalcogen. And then we have a more candidate to be explored. So if you make a transistor using all these three materials and weigh them using the same technique, basically they behave more or less the same. So there is electron doping, and there is a hole doping, and they are more or less having same mobility, and depends on initial doping in the material. We can access a slightly stronger electron side, or very balanced electron hole side, or more pronounced hole side. And if you cool this thing down, nowadays, this is already published, and this is to be published, which is also superconducting. And we don't have a lot of success using the same technique, but we change the technique using a different gate. And nowadays it's also superconducting, and this is going to be appear soon. And so if you induce superconductivity in the electron side, all of them are superconducting with a different TC. And the important thing is to the Hall side, it seems to be a little bit more difficult. So nowadays they all appear more or less metallic, but no superconductivity observed yet. And then you can compare the electron phase with these two different candidates in the same material group. And then they are more or less having all these kind of dome-like structure with the onset of superconductivity at low carrier. So I talked about a lot of material side, and then the point is what is the physical phenomenon inside the system, and I don't know how many times.
10 minutes.
Oh, 10. That's really short. So so I think I just show very briefly what is the physical phenomenon there, and then the point is to compare this system with other system that is a long time known to be a 2D superconductor. So to understand this more effectively, we have to look more carefully in the material itself, which is MOBI disulfide in 2H phase, which is a layer structure. So a unicell contains two layers, and they have an inversion symmetry along inside these two layers. And if you isolate this thing into a monolayer, they lost the inversion symmetry. So there's the inversion symmetry problem. And the material itself is having this kind of honeycomb lattice grain dome, And if you cut on this line, and you will look at this low-lying electron state. Basically, there's a, in the Mach phase, you have a state which is called in the middle of gamma and k point, and there's a highline, there's a state also in gamma point. So if you make them into monolayer, these states start to move up and give rise to the band gap around here. And if you include the spin of interaction and due to the inverter switch broken, and there's the high there's the spin splitting at this high symmetry point. So then we start to compare the same that the, with our system because we are still working on a bulk. How come it is modular? And the argument is that now we are accumulating carrier only at the top of the surface. And in this case, we only go to the surface. A similar system is measured on a bulk crystal doped with potassium. And this potassium only rely on the surface in high height. Yeah?
Yes, is there a conclusive way to know that they're really doping only the first day?
Yeah,
is that cross-check with all measurements?
Cross-check with what?
With all measurements, and then you compare the density with the capacitance? Or?
Yeah, compare with the density and the electronic phase. And I think we are pretty sure that only the first layer is the... Only the first layer is showing superconductivity. And then I think that the most relevant system nowadays measured is this system. We have bulk crystal, we have potassium doped in the on the surface, and there's a charge transfer. And if you measure this with optics, actually the first band we are able to access in the conduction band is actually at K point. So which is not the case that we are accessing this Q point at the, in the ball case. So doping start at K point, and it is like a monolayer. So only difference between these two cases is that this is not the reversible, and this is the reversible. If you remove the gate, then this ion just go away, and this thing, surface become insulated again. So we measured a very large anisotropy in the magneto resistance, and there's a very big difference between this parallel field and perpendicular field. And in the parallel field, in the perpendicular field, we spread the superconductivity easily, and in the parallel field, there's nearly very little change here. So this is around this is less than 1K in the change. And we summarize this behavior at different temperature. We measure the upper critical field with different configuration, and we use the 2D theory to fit it. And then we obtain a thickness which is 3.8 nanometer, and which is smaller than these coherent lines. So I have to say this is a 2D theory of the Ginsburg line, and which is neglecting many things here. So it's not a precise argument that this is a thickness of 3.8 nanometer, but there's a very big difference between these two configurations, and it is a confirmation that this is indeed should be a 2D system. And the precise, so more rigorous proof of this is to measure a critical field as a function of the angle here. And with the big angle, actually it changed quite a lot. And then with big angle, actually with smaller angle, it changed very much when this is very small, when this is 1 degree here. So you can fit this with the two different models, with the 3D model and 2D model. And in the long, in the big scale, they are almost identical. But in small scale, you can see within a range of 2 degrees, and if you measure very carefully, and we start to see this cusp behavior instead of this round swing behavior. So this is the proof that this cusp characteristic is showing this system is 2D. And then we are up measuring up to here.
So this really means that the coherence line root expected to go is way larger than the effective thickness.
Right. So here we only measure up to here, and that, so there's a very important point of Pauli limit here, and we are missing the important data around the high fields. That's the reason that we go to Neimann and to perfect our data and understand. So the point here is actually if we measure our system in the parallel case, there's a very important point to be 2D actually. And the reason is that we can neglect is the orbital effect. And in the previous system, like in the Q-print, we are dealing with the system with 2D sample with a little bit interlayer coupling. So it's basically 2D, but somehow 3D. But our system is only have this Cooper pair, this surface. So basically, it should strictly follow this Pauli limit. Because we are only dealing with spin freedom, a degree of speed. So there's no orbital effect involved. So we prepare two states in our sample, which is having a TC of 2.3K and a TC of 7K, and we measure this into the high field. So clearly you can see that this is a very big field, and with only very big field, we start to see an effect of destroying supercoherent stability. And with higher TC, you cannot even destroy it completely. So this is a summary of the upcritical field. And then you can see that this field is way larger than the this upcritical field that is estimated from TC. And there's a very interesting point that if you just look at the curve, these two curves are actually more parallel, but then these two curves is even bigger, even more steeper. So probably then we start to realize that probably there is a point with the TC or doping in the system that is correlated to the upcritical field. So to our knowledge, there are other systems which is also very famous for very high upcritical field, where basically if you're measuring a triplet, basically it doesn't get destroyed when you apply a parallel field. And if we are working with a Rochester spin orbit interaction under a parallel field, these two spin, when spin are at these two locations, these spin are not coupled with the main field. And when spin is at this location, these start to get coupled. So in our system, we have a honeycomb lab, a honeycomb algorithm. And the electronic state and electronic state is like the following. We have a K and K prime state, and at each state, the electronic band is so we have a higher electronic band which is having spin down, and lower electronic band which is having spin up. And at the different K point, these opposite situation occur. So, effectively, we have a very large main field, which we call the spin orbit, Zeeman type spin orbit coupling, associated with different K or different K prime, that is in order of 100 tesla. And the reason that these things can occur is that the different K or K prime, if you have a pairing, for instance, if pairing between this and this, in its inner band, these magnitude, despite this is 100 tesla, doesn't destroy the Cooper pair in the first place because they are opposite interaction. But they are very, once this kind of configuration is made, they're very strong against the parallel field. So basically, this parallel field doesn't work at all with this kind of system. So if this B field is the product to spin, we have a very strong orthogonal protection due to this attractive Zeeman field. So in our system, actually We are talking about a system which is having a very strong Riemann field. Also, under the electric field, there's a Rushbatite spin orbit interaction. So we are talking about a case of B plus C. So both of them are along this field. And B field is basically, in the B case, is basically not relevant to this field in this direction. But C case is actually coupled partially when the electron, are in this at this point, at that point. So with the increase of this Rushbat type spin orbit interaction, basically the spin configuration is more coupled to the external field. So that's why in the low doping, when the electron when the electric field is low, we have a higher up-equilibrium field and normalized to the with a normalized up-equilibrium field with a long line to the Pauli limit. And then with increase of the gain, we have a stronger Rushbat type spin orbit interaction. Then this up-equilibrium field gets lower. And then the point is that now it's very it's clear that we have Zeeman type and Rushbat type both in this system. And then we start to compare with other systems where the spin protection is very strong. So namely this triplet and the heavy fermion Rushbat type spin of interaction. And then this is a summary of these properties. And then it's fair to say that these things are relatively at higher DC, and spin protection in this system is basically as strong as the other system. And the measure of this is the distance between these dots to the line here. So then there's a point of comparing the present result with the previous result. That is the case of doped phase of this modified software, actually. So in this doped phase, we can there is already a measurement also in this parallel configuration. So in that case, you can see very clearly in normalized Pauli field, Pauli limit, we have a much smaller upper critical field. And this is very different from the case of the surface doped case. So the point is the following. If we only dope at the surface, we have a clear spin orbit, Zeeman type spin orbit interaction. So if it is bulk doping, the different layers start to talk to each other, like in the case of these old 2D cuprases. And then this kind of spin protection gets weaker. And in a case that you are doping with a very large alkaline, for instance, with this ceiling. And then these layers are start to be separated with a larger distance. And probably that's the reason that this upper field is higher. And then if you only go to the top surface, then you get the maximum. That's the case here. So, how to prepare a Ising superconductor? So we need to have this kind of Zeeman spin orbit interaction at K and K prime point. And because of different interaction of spin and effective field, these superconducting phase can exist in the first place. The second thing is that we need to have extreme two-dimensionality so that the auto effect doesn't appear at all. And there is the issue of field effect doping. So field effect doping is doing a lot of things here. So first of all, field effect doping is giving you theory. And this is preparing the state at different theory density. And if we are close to the onset, this is superconducting. First layer is superconducting. The second layer is barely insulated. So we have a very effective monolayer system, and Cooper pair only exists at this monolayer. And this field effect is also breaking emergent symmetry to induce a Zeeman type spin orbit interaction. And also, It is destroying itself by inducing a rush type chain of interaction, which is weakening the protection of a Zeeman type chain of interaction. So we are still working on a bulk. The next thing is whether we can do this in monolayer. And my postdoc might be reluctant to show this, but I want to show this. Yeah, I want to show this, and because I made this, and we will make it when we are back home in the lab. Nowadays, we are working extensively in the monolayer regime, and several samples are already showing superconductivity, and we are very close. So there are miles to go, but we are close. And the good point of this is that if you are working with monolayer, you are never worried about these bands. And then, if we change a different material from moly to tungsten, we can actually tune the size of the splitting. So these states can be prepared with a better defined quality. I think, just a little bit here. But then we are talking about all these inducing the electronic phase. But this is a device phase. The whole purpose eventually should be go to device. So I want to show you a little bit of device flavor that we are playing in the laboratory. So the point is here. So we have this kind of a phase diagram. If we only play at this narrow region, there will be a very good chance with a little effort to play with a very narrow carrier density that go with the superconducting phase and metallic phase. So if we working with here with superconducting phase and we gate down and to reduce carrier density, we can turn this into metallic phase. And it turns out to be very difficult during time in Japan because the hafnium oxide is very leaky and I cannot get a lot of success. But in this particular success sample, we can see that it's very nice because we are working with 10K, the previous system working with 0.3K, and we are working with a few volts. And the previous system, yeah, you see it, it's 600 volts, right? You are not supposed to put 600 volts in a transistor, effectively. So it's a very nice system to play with a lot of device play. And then we want to work more on that. And a student is very, very good at enhance the property. And nowadays we can apply about 20 volts to hafnium oxide. And these things are controlled much, much more effectively. So we are controlling superconducting state. And then associated with this, we are controlling DC, DC, and IC, all these. And then there are subtle issue of this dimensionality. But all these parameters can be controlled very nicely. So nowadays, starting with the superconducting phase, and you can switch it off. And then with the preparing the superconducting phase, you can switch on the upper critical field. And then with a different gate voltage, you can prepare a superconducting state and a metallic phase. So by all this, I will send my hardworking group, the postdocs and student and technician, and with help from Highfield Lab in Nanyang, and the theory support from Hong Kong, and many in-house support from colleagues, and I will thank you for your attention.